Hello and welcome to another Design Cuts video tutorial. Today we're going to be looking at global color. We're going to see what global color is, how you can make use of it in your designs, and what you can do if you inherit a design or create a design and suddenly realize that you want to use global colors with it. Now, before we get into the video tutorial, I'm going to be using elements in this tutorial from various Design Cuts collections. So I thought you'd be interested in seeing where they come from. Everything that I'm using today is one of our freebies. So I'm using some elements from Watercolor Floral and Birthday Party Vectors Pack. I'm also using some elements from the Festive Vectors Textures and Frames Pack. And the final freebie I'm using is Vector Florals Avatars, Patterns, Shapes and Banners. So now let's head back to Illustrator. The design that we're seeing on the screen right now has been designed with global colors, and we can tell that by opening up the Swatches palette. And what you'll see in the Swatches palette is that some of the colors here have little white triangles in their bottom right corners, and that tells us that they are global colors. And when somebody uses global colors in an illustration like this, it makes it very easy to change the colors. Let's go and target this sort of blue color here, but notice that I don't have anything in this illustration selected. I'm going to double click on this blue color and I'm going to change it. So I'm going to turn preview on and I'm going to make it a slightly different color. I'm going to set the color mode to HSB, but you could stick to CMYK if you wanted to. I'm just going to show you what happens when we make changes to a color. Now the color I just changed was the color that was used to color this scarf. And in changing the global color, you can see that we've changed the color used in the scarf. But we did that without selecting the scarf. So that's one of the benefits of global colors. You can make changes to the colors without needing to select an object that has been colored with that global color. So global colors make really good sense to use when you're developing illustrations because it makes it so much easier to change things. So we could have half a dozen or even 100 objects colored with a single color. And if we use a global color, then we can change the color of all of those objects by simply double clicking on the Swatches panel. And we don't have to have any of the objects selected. So if global colors are so useful, how do we get our own global colors? Well, let's head to our second birthday party freebies because this particular design comes with a series of colors, but there aren't any global colors in use in this document. So we're going to create these colors here as global colors. First of all, I'm going to click on the eyedropper icon because I want to get this color here in the swatch. So I'm doing it by selecting the color here, but you could just create any color that you like. Once I've selected that color, I can come across to the Swatches panel and click New Swatch. And this is the color that I selected from down here. If I click on Global, then it's going to be added to the Swatches panel as a global color. And here it is. It's got the little triangle in the corner. So I'm going to select another color, click the new swatch icon, make sure it's global and click OK. In the same way, I can sample all the colors from this little mini color palette here and add them all as global colors to the document. I can then use them when I'm coloring the elements in this document, and so I'll be applying global colors to these elements. It's important that you set up your global colors before you actually use them to color elements in a document if you want to be able to easily change them later on and if you want to take advantage of the concept of using global colors. So let's go and color an object with our new global colors. I'm going to zoom in to the ice cream here. I've got my group selection tool selected so I can get access to the objects within this group. And I'm going to give it a sort of mint ice cream look. And now let's go ahead and select the cone. Well, the cone seems to be a series of individual objects, so I'm using the lasso tool to lasso these objects. And then I can apply this lighter color as the cone. And we'll finish off with the cherry. And let's go for a sort of reddy brown cherry. Now, if I click away from these objects and go and change one of these global colors, then the object that's colored with that global color is going to change as well. no, I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to cancel out of here for now. Now you might be wondering what will happen if you've already colored an object like I have here and you didn't use global colors. Well, there is a way of getting around the problem and converting these colors to global colors. Let's zoom into the cupcake here, which I've gone ahead and colored with a series of colors, none of which are global colors. So I'm going to select over the cupcake. And I'm going to the swatches panel. I'm going to click here on New Color Group, because this allows me to create a color group from the colors in this piece of artwork. And as I'm doing that, if I click this check mark here, I'll be converting these process colors into global colors as I do it. So I'm just going to click OK. So now we have some additional global colors. So if I want to change the color of the cherry on top here, I can double click on this global color and change it. As I do, the color in the cherry changes, even though I haven't selected the cherry. Of course, I'll need to be very careful when I do something like that, because changing a global color is going to affect everywhere in the document where that color has been used. It's also possible to create tints of a global color. So I'm going to color this cupcake, and I'm going to color it a sort of deep purple. So I'm going to double click on this color because I want to make it a global color. So I'm going to make sure it's a global color, and let's just darken it a little bit before we start. So I now have this purple as a global color. I'm going to click the color guide. Because this purple is selected, I'm able to get tints of that same color, all of which are global colors. So I'm going to select an object within this group. Let's just go for the base of the cupcake and let's color it with this darker color. Then I'll select this piece and color it a little bit lighter, and then a little bit lighter. And finally, lighter still. Now let's go to the swatches panel, because we just have one color of which these are all tints of that color. So again, with nothing selected in this image, I'm going to double click on this color and let's change it to something completely different. So let's make it a sort of green. And when I click the preview button, you'll see that the entire object has recolored to tints of this global color. So you could apply shadings and highlights to an object using tints of a global color so that everything can be changed to a different color very easily if needed later on. Let's look now at the situation where you have some elements that are colored using global colors. In this case, all the houses are colored using these two global colors, and you want to start breaking them out. Well, if you want to start breaking them out and coloring them global colors, you'll need to start by creating those global colors. So I'm going to create this color here, this color of blue, as a global color. And I'm going to go ahead and color this one a global color, or convert it to a global color. So you'll set up your global colors before you start. Now I want to select this house. So I'm going to select the lasso tool. And that's going to allow me to lasso around the house here. And because I want to color the windows first of all, I'm going to the group select tool, and I'm going to hold the shift key and just click on the house. That deselects the house, but makes sure that the windows are all selected. And now I can go ahead and color them my global color by just clicking on that global color. With the group selection tool still targeted, I'm going to click on the house, and now I can color it my second global color. So I'm still using global colors, but by selecting various objects that are already colored with a different global color, I can easily change them. But in this case, I'm not changing all the houses because that's not what I wanted to do. I wanted to start using global colors, but break some of these houses out to a different set. Global colors are really valuable when you're working with things like a custom color scheme or a corporate color scheme. It just makes it so easy to change colors and also to confirm that the right colors are in use throughout your document. I hope that you've enjoyed learning these Illustrator techniques for working with global colors. Let us know what you think in the comments below, and give us a thumbs up if you enjoyed the tutorial. I'm Helen Bradley. Until next time.